When people talk about space, most of the time they are referring to the observable universe, also known as the Hubble volume. This is a spherical, geocentric slice of space which surrounds the Earth, containing all the galaxies and matter that can be observed by our instruments, because their light emissions have had time to reach the solar system. As we know, light travels omnidirectionally into space from a luminous source, at a finite speed of just under 300,000 kilometers per second. And while this is exceptionally fast on earthly scales, over the largest cosmic distances, it is agonizingly slow, and any meaningful intergalactic distance beyond the Milky Way incurs a substantial light delay in the emissions reaching Earth. This causes objects to appear younger, and is why astronomers find so much use in using light years as a unit of measurement. If a galaxy lies 1 billion light years from Earth, we will see it as it was 1 billion years ago. And in this sense, the edge of the universe is a time barrier as much as anything, constrained by its finite age of 13.8 billion years. There's an old saying that a telescope is a time machine, and a telescope like James Webb is a TARDIS, whose ultra-sharp infrared eyes are, at this very moment, staring deeper into space than ever before, allowing us to know the cosmos at every single stage of its life. And throughout all of this life cycle, the universe has been expanding in volume, and we can see evidence of this ingrained upon the light reaching us from space, which arrives elongated and reddened due to a phenomenon known as redshift. Redshift occurs when patterns of photons travelling towards Earth experience a decrease in wavelength, in this case because they are being separated by the expansion of space. The local group extends about 10 million light years, though its four most significant galaxies all lie within a relatively close proximity. In fact, the group's three largest members appear to be on a collision course, as they are drawn together by gravity, overcoming the weak expansion of the universe. Therefore, we don't notice any sort of red shift until we travel beyond the local group. Outside of its bounds, we stray into the wider local volume, another, smaller geocentric slice of local space, encompassing all the galaxies within about 30 million light years of the Earth. Extending out to around redshift 0.002, this volume contains us and the rest of the local group, alongside more than 500 other fascinating nearby galaxies, each arranged into their own local aggregations. One such not-so-local group is the Council of Giants, a ring of 12 galaxies roughly the size of the Milky Way or larger, which appear to surround our local group. Being so large and massive, many of these galaxies also host their own smaller extragalactic neighbourhoods, like the Sculptor Group, hosted by the Council of Giants Sculptor Galaxy. Officially designated NGC 253, the Sculptor Galaxy lies around 11 million light-years from Earth, and is classed as a starburst galaxy, a galaxy undergoing a vigorous period of star formation, making it one of the most intrinsically luminous galaxies within our local slice. And when a large amount of gas collects at the centre of a galaxy, particularly around its black hole nucleus, all sorts of weird and wonderful electromagnetic processes can arise. When a galaxy's central black hole interacts with this gas, we call it an active galactic nucleus, because it invariably leads to the release of an enormous amount of radiant energy, amplifying the galaxy's luminosity in at least some electromagnetic wavelengths, for example in the radio spectrum. Radio galaxies are one such type of active galactic nucleus, invariably occurring within elliptical galaxies like M87. As gas orbiting this galaxy's nucleus is ionized, subatomic particles become entrapped within the black hole's magnetic field and are funneled onto its polar axes. This matter is then blasted away from the event horizon at near light speed velocities by a pair of twin relativistic jets, carrying the material off at high energies for thousands of light years into space. Unlike within a radio galaxy, which is driven by the jets emanating from the nucleus, a quasar's emissions are driven more so by the accretion disk surrounding the black hole. Within a spinning accretion disk, subatomic particles race round at extraordinary velocities, smashing into other particles and releasing thermal energy through friction. This friction superheats the material in the disk to millions of kelvins, and often even hotter, causing it to radiate electromagnetic energy and light some 50 times more efficiently than the nuclear fusion reaction enabling the shining of the sun. This results in the release of unfathomable quantities of luminous, radiant energy, almost uniformly across the electromagnetic spectrum. Quasar galaxies shine hundreds of thousands of times brighter than the Milky Way, so powerful that they can impersonate the stars in our galaxy from billions of light years beyond the Earth, like the Sloan Great Wall. Large quasar groups are assortments of quasars scattered over multi-billion light-year distances. And though the groupings themselves are not believed to be gravitationally linked, their aggregations still rank among the largest structures we've ever seen. Gazing 8.8 billion light-years from Earth, we find the first of three record-breaking quasar groups, U1.11. It is a gamma-ray burst formation. A gamma-ray burst is the most powerful type of electromagnetic explosion, releasing as much energy as the sun's entire life cycle in a matter of seconds. But unlike quasars and radio galaxies, gamma-ray bursts don't tend to be associated with active galactic nuclei. Rather, they often occur as a result of exceptionally violent supernova explosions, or when a pair of neutron stars collide to form a black hole. After the Big Bang ended, its plasma was harvested to form the first neutral hydrogen and helium gas. But as this gas gave rise to population 3 stars, their irradiating stellar emissions began to reverse this process, re-ionizing the gas, as its electrons were stripped by ultraviolet radiation. Lasting about 150 million years, and concluding at redshift 6, the epoch of re-ionization ended when the majority of the once neutral gas had been converted back into charged plasma. A key question for astronomers studying this age is, was the universe's reionization shared democratically among all galaxies, or was the majority driven by a few large galactic oligarchs, which acted as ionization powerhouses? The final stop on our cosmic journey is the universe's very own baby picture, a snapshot of the moment the Big Bang ended, when it was just 379,000 years old. This cosmic background radiation began its journey as optical light, emitted by the vanishing high-energy plasma which condensed to form the first atoms. All the photons that came before this moment were absorbed by the primordial plasma before it disappeared, and are thus undetectable to us today. And so, for all intents and purposes, the cosmic microwave background is as much the edge of the universe as the twilight curtain. The radius of our observable universe is measured by the distance travelled by its oldest light's photons.